Our first reading for today is from 2 Chronicles, chapter 31. Hezekiah assigned the priests and Levites to divisions, each of them according to their duties, and priests or Levites to offer burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, to minister, to give thanks, and to sing praises at the gates of the Lord's dwelling. The king contributed from his own possessions for the morning and evening burnt offerings, and for the burnt offerings of the Sabbaths, at the new moons, and at the appointed festivals, as written in the law of the land. He ordered the people living in Jerusalem to give the portion due the priests and Levites so that they could devote themselves to the law of the Lord. As soon as the order went out, the Israelites generously gave of their first fruits of their grain, new wine, olive oil, and honey, and all that the fields produced. They brought a great amount, a tithe of everything. The people of Israel and Judah who lived in the towns of Judah also brought a tithe of their herds and flocks and a tithe of the holy things dedicated to the Lord their God, and they piled them in heaps. They began doing this in the third month and finished in the seventh month. Here ends the reading. Our second reading is from Hebrews chapter 7. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God the Most High. He met Abraham returning from the defeat of the kings and blessed him. And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, the name Melchizedek means king of righteousness. Then also, king of Salem means king of peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, resembling the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now the law requires that the descendants of Levi who became priests to collect a tenth from the people. That is, from their fellow Israelites, even though they also are descended from Abraham. This man, however, did not trace his descent from Levi. Yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. And without doubt, the lesser is blessed by the greater. In one case, the tenth is collected by people who die, but in the other case, by him who is declared to be living. One might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth through Abraham, because when Melchizedek met Abraham, Levi was still in the body of his ancestor. Here ends the reading.
Please stand as you're able.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading today Mary, turn this one down, please. Thank you. The gospel reading today is taken from Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 through 24. Jesus said, "Do not store up your treasures on earth, where moths and vermin destroy, where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin do not destroy, and where the thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are healthy, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are unhealthy, your whole body will be full of darkness. If then the light within you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." The gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. So we, for the last 5 weeks now, this is 6 weeks, have been on a journey on the marks of discipleship, what it is to be a disciple, the things that help us stay focused on becoming a disciple, the things that tell us that we're in that right track. I'm going to have these passed around, not to you guys yet, but I'd like you to take these and take a card, and we'll start with you, Rick, and start passing it back and pass it all the way forward. This card has all six marks of discipleship. Put it up in a refrigerator. Put it in your wallet. Put it in your purse. It's a way to reach down and remind yourself of what those marks are. The things that we strive for. Because we're not going to get it perfect. And we're going to miss some of the marks. But this is a way to get us back on track. Discipleship is about following in the ways of Jesus. So you remember, it said that they were followers of the way. So the first people that followed Jesus were followers of the way. They weren't called Christians, but followers of the way. A new way. Followers of Jesus who led that way. Discipleship is about individual Christians and the church as a community of Christians living in mission. So we do this together. We don't do this isolated. That's why one of the first things is you need to be coming to worship. So you need to be in prayer so you're connected with God. You need to be in worship so we're connected with each other. You need to be in Bible reading so that we hear the word of God. And then we need to be engaged in service so that we're out with others again. And then we need to have spiritual friendships so we can share with. And the final piece is giving. Now, giving is more than money. Giving is far more than money. It's giving of time and talents. Just coming up and doing a reading is giving. So thank you for doing that reading today. Setting up communion is part of giving as well. Steve didn't know that he'd be giving of himself today by doing the streaming. Mary did not know that she'd be giving by doing, for the first time, the slides. But that's part of giving as well. Because that is part of being a discipleship, a missional church, a body of people sent on mission who gather in community for worship. We are doing that today. Community and encouragement and teaching from the Word in addition to what they are self-feeding themselves throughout the week. I am church. Not that I go to church, but I am church. Completely different. So giving for a disciple is done out of gratitude, not out of obligation, not because it will save us. Skip, pass those cards back up this side now. Thank you. It's done because of gratitude not obligation. Giving for a disciple is out of an attitude of gratitude and a response to God for what God has first given us. An attitude in gratitude for what God has given us, what God gives us, and what God will give us. The attitude or response for a disciple is to give to a free will, loving, in a free will, loving response to a gracious and loving God who gives and gave graciously and mercifully to you. Hear that again. The attitude of response for a disciple is to give in a free will, loving response, in a free will, loving response to a gracious and loving God who gave and gives graciously and mercifully to you. That's the attitude of response that we do when we give. So when we sign up to do these things and we give of ourselves, that is the response. When you sign up and you start bringing in some things in for the craft fair, because we need things for the craft fair to be able to sell those things, that is part of giving as well. It means that we can sell those things and raise funds to continue doing mission. Because ultimately, without us giving dollars as well, without us giving to doing the readings, the slides, the streaming, if we don't give to those things, we can't do mission. In our green hymnal, the Lutheran Book of Worship, there is a prayer about giving, and the prayer goes, "Merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Signs of your gracious love, we give back these things, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Signs of your gracious love." And it continues and says, "Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who gave of himself to death for you, for me." From Power of Surge, it says, "In a membership-driven church, the offering can often be seen as a payment of dues, a fee for services rendered." Think about that. All these professional things that are done, therefore we pay to make sure the professional things happen again. In a discipleship church, though, the offering is a symbolic one, a giving of oneself to God who loves us with an everlasting love. We give as a symbolic of the giving of oneself to the God who loves us with an everlasting love. It's not done begrudgingly, but with joy and thanksgiving. For disciples, giving should be as natural as receiving. It's hard sometimes, especially among siblings, to give, right? But you like to share with your sister sometimes, right?
Yeah.
But that's what we grow up with, and we learn, you know, real quickly not to share. But God continues to share with us, continues to be engaged with us, and gives of himself with us. He gives us an everlasting love. So how do we respond to that? Well, giving is giving of monies, giving of time, service, prayer, worship, Bible reading, it's all that, but it's also more. It just doesn't stop there. Giving is speaking abundantly positive about the church, the congregation you attend, and the members, and even the pastor. Giving allows for ministry to happen. Giving allows, where is she? Walker, giving allows for you to be here and to be baptized. Giving allows, and there's nothing I can do. There's nothing I can do. If we're not streaming, I'm sorry, there's nothing I can do. These people are important right now. So giving allows us to do a baptism. Giving allows us to do ministry. Giving allows us to take care of this child that says, we will baptize her, and we will all say that we will help raise her in the church. Not just her parents, not just the godparents, not her grandparents, not the sponsor. All of us will be saying that we will raise her in this church, and we will help them and support them. But if we don't have lights on, we can't do that. If we don't have the doors open, we can't do that. So giving is important. Giving allows us to support each other and those that come through that door each and every time. Giving is not out of obligation. It's not paying dues. It's not giving of words that reflect poorly upon the church, the congregation, its members, or its pastor. Giving for a disciple is opposite of what others might consider non-Christian-like behavior. Here's the thing, folks. Non-Christians and non-churchgoers know how disciples act. Non-Christians, non-churchgoers know how disciples act, how they should be acting, if they're truly responding to God and following Christ. A non-Christian's understanding there is daily prayer, weekly worship, Bible reading, service, spiritual friendships, and giving. They get those pieces are even not what they do, but they know that's what you do. They know that's who a disciple is. They know that's what a disciple should be. Again, from Power Surge. Once again, we are faced with the need to challenge and change the culture of the church. A membership-driven culture is characterized by an entitlement mentality. A discipleship-driven church culture is characterized by a generosity rooted in the generosity of God. So here at Central Lutheran, we are working on a special appeal to reduce our debt to the outstanding loan over at the fellowship hall. You know that where are we sitting at right now? Still about 32?
Just over
30,000 still owed on that. Just to pay the balloon payment that was not, principal was not paid, no interest was not paid during the pandemic. So we owe $30,000 by next August. Not counting what we're behind in giving since January. And I'm not talking about summer, because summer is a different piece. But we're behind in giving to our regular bills. And we have that bill. We need to give so that we can continue to do baptisms, so that we can still continue to have children come to this church, so that the future is secure, so that we have a place to come and worship. So eventually you're going to be asked to fill out a pledge card and make a plan of your giving. This should be a plan between you and God. That's a free will, loving response to a gracious and loving God who gave, gives, and will give graciously and mercifully to each of us. Again, from Power Surge, the author writes, first, we are continually reminded who the giver of all abundance really is. God is the creator of all that we have and all that we are. Practicing the tithe reminds us, tithe, if you don't know, is 10%. Practicing the tithe reminds us of our total dependence upon God. It keeps us focused on generosity and makes us co-givers with God as our gifts are used by the body of Christ to bring blessings to others. Co-givers with God to bring blessings to others. Second, tithing has the capacity to put the things of this world into perspective. There's nothing inherently wrong with wealth or possessions. Anybody have a car? Wow, a lot of people don't have cars. You guys, what time did you leave to get here? How many have a car that's less than 5 years old? It's okay to have those. It's okay to have those. It's okay to have a second car. Possessions are not bad. Where your heart is where it turns into a problem. Having possessions, those came from God. You got a big truck. I know. I hear it in the morning. My neighbor, you've got a big truck. Having those things are okay. Having is not bad. The writer of 1 Timothy reminds us, it is not money, but the love of money that is the root of all kinds of evil. 1 Timothy 6:10. Jesus reminds us that no one can serve God and wealth. Matthew 6:24. Disciples, by definition, serve God. Tithing is an ongoing reminder of where our loyalties belong. It keeps us focused with our attention fixed on what is finally and ultimately important. Our Lord and Savior, God the Father, and the Holy Spirit. Not that we have the newest hymnals in the pews, because even the ELW, the red one, isn't the cranberry one, isn't the newest one. Now they have a purple one, not the blue ones. Having the best seats isn't here, is not the ultimate important, but serving and loving God, that is the ultimate importance. It might mean that we need to recover all of these, I'm just saying. Might mean that we need to recover all these and welcome other people in. Might not. Ultimately, as we go through this whole process that the council is going through of a vision for Central Lutheran, we will learn what God has in mind for us. I am sure that God does not have in mind for us to close tomorrow, or the next day, or the next month, or the next 6 months, or the next year. God has in mind that Walker there will bring her child here to get baptized. And the next generations of people will be here to say, we will support you. We will gather with you. We will uplift you. We will care for you and help you be brought into the Scriptures. Clarity in Jesus' teaching is what we need. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourself treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consume, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Matthew 6:19-21. The disciples' heart belongs to God. Tithing is a spiritual discipline. Tithing, giving of one's time, giving of one's self, giving of one's possessions, the money that was given to them by God, is a spiritual practice. Folks, when we pray and we say thanks for those that gave and those who wanted to give, we give thanks to God. We can all work towards tithing. Nobody says we have to go from 1% to 10% overnight. But we can all, if we really think about it, give just a little bit more for the sake of the kingdom, for the sake of her and others that come. We can get there. We can take care of that debt. We can take care of the big loan, which is $72,000 overall. We can make up the difference that we're down from January, which is last count, around $51,000. We can do this Because with God, everything is possible. Nothing happens without God. Not one single thing happens without God. If you need help setting up electronic giving, ask me, ask a councilman, or we'll get you set up. Because one of the things that causes our giving to go down is we have people that go away for summer, right? Because they think it's too hot here in Arizona for summer. But when we do electronic giving and we set it up that it occurs weekly or monthly or bi-monthly, then those monies still keep coming in. It helps Rick not lose any more hair than he already has. So he doesn't have to pull that out wondering, how are we going to pay the bills? When we passed a budget, a.k.a. really a mission support plan, we said we want this congregation to go out and take care of people, to have missions available. We want everyone engaged in that. So we passed this mission support plan in January. And we're going to pass another one next January. And we need to keep giving to it. Sometimes your giving can only be reading. Sometimes your giving can only be pushing the button. Sometimes it might be just bringing cookies for fellowship. But we can all give something. Somewhere, at some time. I don't expect everyone to get out there in direct traffic for Rick when we do the food bank out there. But we can give in our own rights. Giving is a spiritual practice. Giving is part of the marks of discipleship, along with daily prayer, weekly worship, Bible reading, service, and spiritual friendship. Give back to God with an attitude of gratitude. Give in a loving, free-willed response to a gracious and loving God.